I invite you to pray the prayer intentions, which I also forgot to change for this month, and forgive me for that. But please invite you to pray those prayer intentions, and may the Lord bless us as we worship this morning. Oh, and let's add a prayer intention for Jeffersonville Assembly. Okay. All right. May the Lord bless us as we worship.
Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
With you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. You created those wicked people, and no one can speak in their defense or condemn you for destroying them. No one can question what you have done or challenge your judgment. All things are under your care, and there is no other God to whom you must justify your decisions. No king or ruler on earth can accuse you of punishing those people unfairly. You are righteous, and you rule everything righteously. You have never used your power to condemn a person who does not deserve to be punished. Your strength is the source of justice. You can show mercy to everyone because you are the Lord of all. You show your strength when people doubt that your power is perfect, and you punish anyone who knows your power but dares to ignore it. Even though you have absolute power, you are a merciful judge. You could take action against us whenever you like, but instead, you rule us with great patience. By the things you have done, you have taught your people that a person who is righteous must also be kind. You have given your people abundant hope by allowing them to repent of their sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. I consider that what we suffer at this present time cannot be compared at all with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. All of creation waits with eager longing for God to reveal his children. For creation was condemned to lose its purpose, not of its own will, but because God willed it to be so. Yet there was the hope that creation itself would one day be set free from its slavery to decay and would share the glorious freedom of the children of God. For we know that up to the present time, all the creation groans with pain, like the pains of childbirth. But it is not just creation alone that groans. We who have the Spirit as the first of God's gifts also groan within ourselves as we wait for God to make us his children and set our whole being free. For it was by hope that we were saved. But if we see what we hope for, then it is not really hope. For who of us hopes for something we see? But if we hope for what we do not see, we will wait for it with patience. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you to stand as you read. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like this. A man sowed good seed in his field. One night, when everyone was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the plants grew and the heads of grain began to form, then the weeds showed up. The man's servants came to him and said, "Sir, it was good seed you sowed in your field. Where did the weeds come from?" "It was some enemy who did this," he answered. "Do you want us to go and pull up the weeds?" they asked him. "No," he answered, "because as you gather the weeds, you might pull up some of the wheat along with them. Let the wheat and the weeds both grow together until harvest. Then I will tell the harvest workers to pull up the weeds first, tie them in bundles and burn them, and then to gather the wheat and put it in my barn." When Jesus had left the crowd and gone indoors, his disciples came to him and said, "Tell us what the parable of the weeds in the field means." Jesus answered, "The man who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed is the people who belong to the kingdom. The weeds are the people who belong to the evil one. And the enemy who sowed the weeds is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvest workers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered up and burned in the fire, so the same thing will happen at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels to gather up out of his kingdom all those who cause people to sin and all others who do evil things. And they will throw them into the fiery furnace, where they will cry and gnash their teeth. Then God's kingdom will shine like the sun. God's people will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. Listen then, if you have ears." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. We are hungry, Lord. We are hungry for that which gives life and sustains us day by day. Come and fill us with the power of your word. Nourish us in the truth and feed us with your love. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's a busy morning in what is going to be a very busy day. You get up, your alarm clock doesn't get you up at the time you need to get up, or you hit snooze and didn't realize you did it. You get into the bathroom to take the shower, and you realize that there are a couple of things that you thought you could do in the morning that you would leave until then, because frankly, you were tired when you went to bed. And so on top of rushing, you have to do these things. You get out of the house, you get into your car, you back out of the driveway, and the first of the rolling roadblocks hits you. You have to wait at the end of your driveway while somebody moves along at 5 miles an hour. You get to the first stoplight. Yes, it's red. It's not green. And you are third or fourth back in that line, and whoever's in front of you decides that they're half awake too, and they're just not going to quite get through that light until you get there and the light has gone yellow into red. And you want to cry out to the Lord, "I'm trying to do your will, Jesus. I'm trying to be about your business. Why have I got to endure all of these roadblocks? why, when I'm trying to serve you, am I hindered? And when I'm not trying to do something for you, I have a free and clear path. Why, Lord? Raise your hand if you've ever had something similar to that go through your head. Yes? I've heard it from lay people. I've heard it from clergy. I've heard it from missionaries. I've heard it from teachers. I've heard it from officers in a prison. I've heard it from inmates in the prison. I've heard it from everybody I can possibly hear it from. And I am constantly on my own, in my own way, crying out to the Lord the very same thing. But we know what he wants us to do. We know that he wants us to endure. We know that when we encounter the roadblocks, complaining is not the thing he wants. He wants us to look around and see why there might be a roadblock. Sometimes it's because he has ordained it. Sometimes it's because he's trying to save us from something that we don't want to encounter. Perhaps there's an accident that is going to happen, and he doesn't want us in that accident because that would really hinder the work that we're trying to do for him. Perhaps it's because he's trying to build patience in us. He's trying to get us to see that we must endure in order to hope, and in order to hope, we have to have character. And he wants to build his character in us. And what is the hallmark of his character? It is patient grace. Waiting. Waiting for the ones who are erring. Sometimes us, most of the time the world around us, sometimes more often than we would like, both. He wants us to be like him. He wants us to exercise patient grace instead of reacting badly to the chores that we left for ourselves last night instead of doing them, instead of cursing at those chores. He wants us to take it as a sign that we need to think better. Instead of cursing the drivers that are making our way to wherever we're going difficult, he's wanting us to pray for them. Probably, the truth be told, he's also wanting us to pray for ourselves, because if we're upset at that point, that's not a good sign. Reminds me of what we read from the Wisdom of Solomon this morning. This is the writer speaking to the Lord. Okay? That's important to understand. The writer of this is actually speaking this to the Lord. You created those wicked people, or tasks, or whatever else is holding us back. And no one can speak in their defense or condemn you for destroying them. And there are times when we wish that we could have a laser in the front of our car. No one can question what you've done or challenge your judgment. All things are under your care, and there's no other God to whom you must justify your decisions. Lord, I'm trying to do what you want me to do. Clear the way. Instead of working on me, Lord, work on them. Clear the way. You have never used your power to condemn a person who does not deserve to be punished. Lord, you can do this. You have your right to do this. Your strength is the source of justice. You can show mercy to everyone because you are the Lord of all. And then, if we are listening, and that's really so key, if we are listening, we will hear with the ears of our heart the words that I'm about to speak. Again, speaking to the Lord. Even though you have absolute power, you are a merciful judge. You could take action against us whenever you like, but instead you rule us with great patience. God's character, The writer of Wisdom of Solomon is actually drawing out the deepest essence of God's character, but instead, you rule with great patience. By the things you've done, you've taught your people that a person who is righteous must also be kind, slow to anger, gentle, forbearing, patient, the fruits of the Spirit, right? And then he says, you have given your people abundant hope by allowing them to repent of their sins. By the time we reflect on our crying out against the roadblocks and the impediments that we must endure, we begin to realize that God is being patient with us. We begin to realize that we are the target at that moment. Not the person in the other car, not the obstacle in the way in the bathroom in the morning, not the alarm clock that we shut off, but us, we ourselves, are the ones that he's wanting to work on. Jesus shares this parable and so often, when we think about it deeply, the things that we have to endure, the things we have to persevere over and against, are like these weeds that grow up in the midst of what God is wanting to grow within us and around us. We begin to realize that if we curse the other person, if we get angry or impatient with the tasks at hand, we are attempting, really and truly, to tear up the weeds within us and the weeds around us. And that's dangerous business, because the patient grace of God does not want us to go there. Do you want us to pull up the weeds, they asked the owner. No, he answered. Because as you gather the weeds, you might pull up some of the wheat along with them. Let the wheat and the weeds both grow together until harvest. Then I'll tell the harvest workers to pull up the weeds first. Now, we are to invite the Lord in his timing and in his way to pull up the weeds within us. But it's different when we look at the weeds around us. Because those weeds not only are being shown the patient grace of God, those weeds are also there so that we can take on God's character within ourselves to be perfect as the Lord our God is perfect, to be holy as the Lord our God is holy, to be patient as the Lord our God is patient, and to work with the weeds that are around us and bring the good news to bear in those situations. That's difficult work. But here's a link that we don't often make. When we exercise the patient grace of God, when we endure the weeds that have grown up and don't pull them out because the master said don't pull them out yet, that is precisely when he begins pulling the weeds within us. That is precisely when he begins to separate within us the good from the bad, the holy from the unholy. That is when he begins to really work his righteousness within us. And so Jesus says, the Son of Man will send out his angels to gather up out of his kingdom all those who cause people to sin and all those who do evil things, and they will throw them into the fiery furnace. They will cry and gnash their teeth. Then God's people will shine like the sun in their Father's kingdom. And he calls us to listen to this. When we call out, when we cry out to him, when we complain to him, we are, in essence, in the birth pangs of a new creation. Paul talks about this so beautifully in today's portion from his letter to the Romans. He says, I consider that what we suffer at this present time cannot be compared at all with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. We need to see in the weeds and the wheat, both around us and within us, the thing that God is trying to bring about and the methodology by which he's trying to bring it about. Yes, he could come in, storm the ramparts, and destroy everything that is not holy. But that means that you and I would not have anywhere near the chance to try to grow in his character, to try to be like him as we encounter those things. All creation waits with eager longing for God to reveal his children. I love this sentence. All of creation waits with eager longing for God to reveal his children. What does Paul mean? He means that in the exercise of patient grace, God's children are revealed. We are revealed when we make the choice to see the situations around us and within us the way God sees them, and to react to them the way God wants us to react to them, rather than the way we would want to react to them. And I talk often about the example of, you know, road rage and all of the things that go on the highways and byways, but it's a prime example. And it can be multiplied by the stories we can share about our families, our neighbors, our co-workers, our friends, etc. Because it's all there, all the time. And then Paul says, there was the hope that creation itself would one day be set free from its slavery to decay and would share the glorious freedom of the children of God. We still have that hope. We hope in the one, we put our trust in the one who tells us that we can endure and that we should endure. He gives us the grace to do it. But it's not just creation alone which groans. We who have the Spirit as the first of God's gifts also groan within ourselves as we wait for God to make us his children and set our whole being free. This work of enduring, this work of persevering, this work of looking past what is not right around us and allowing the Lord to deal with what is not right within us is the very thing that God is calling us to do. This is Christian endurance. And so, this morning, as we ponder things in our lives, things within us, in our inscape, as well as on the landscape around us, as we ponder these things, it's okay to complain, but the complaining must lead to growing. It must lead to listening. As Jesus said, let those who have ears listen. Listen to the voice of our own complaining and realize what we are doing. And then realize what God wants us to do. Because those are two different things. May he give us the grace to hear. May he give us the grace to see. And may he give us the grace to patiently endure what we must endure. Father, we know that you bring all things together for the good of those who believe in you, who trust in you. And so we ask you this morning to give us the grace to see when we are complaining, to give us the grace to see how that means that we are not responding the way you want us to respond. And then to indeed open up our ears and listen. Listen to what's going on within us, and even more importantly, listen to how you are wanting us to respond to that. Open our hearts and our minds, Lord. Open our eyes and our ears, that we would totally see and hear and acknowledge your ways in all of these things. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand as you're able. Here we go. We believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Foley, our Archbishop, Ronald, our Bishop, and Roger and Peter, our assisting bishops, for the people of this parish, and for all ministers and Christian people. Let us pray for the church. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Let us pray for justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Let us pray for those in any need or trouble. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of him. let us pray that they may find and be found by him. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
I ask your prayers for the faithful departed. Let us pray for those who have died. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Let us pray for the grace to glorify Christ in our own day. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, hear the prayers of your people and what we have asked faithfully. Grant that we may obtain effectually to the glory of your name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able. Beloved, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
May be seated. I want to mention two things that I didn't mention at the beginning of the, or before the beginning of the liturgy, and this moment in the liturgy is actually a time that can be set aside for announcements as well. Two thank yous. First, for Pete, checking out the pathway for the air conditioning. There's actually air coming out over there and some over here. Pete, thank you so much for
yes,
that.
Thank you.
Much appreciated. And then you may notice that even though your vicar belatedly got a hold of the items to be embroidered and whatnot, Miss Alice went to town this week and got us up to date in our season. We were supposed to be green after the feast of the Sacred Heart of Jesus. So we're a few Sundays behind because of me, but Alice, thank you. They look beautiful as usual. Much appreciated.
Thank you.
All right. Having given thanks to each of you and for each of you to the Lord, I also want to say this. Coming to the Holy Table, let us remember these words. If you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. May we come to the Lord's table with an open and pure heart.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of heaven. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. Receive, O Lord, these gifts presented by your people for the work of your church.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, all of ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
With you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me."
Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Mary and Blessed Martha of Bethany, and all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that takes away the sins of the world.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but speak the word only, and I shall be healed.
Beloved, the gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May our Heavenly Father, who in Christ Jesus gives us a spring of water, welling up to eternal life, perfect in you the image of his glory, and the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Mass has ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.